So one of the email we get, and thank you for all those emails, one of them was a question about Erev Rav. Erev Rav or Asaf Suf is a word that expresses in the Torah toward the multitude people that joined our ancestors when they left Egypt. So we'll talk about it later. Also, a single individual come and ask a question in regards to, he's one of those Jewish boys that is no longer among the youngest, and how do you say it, he's still under his mother's skirt, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
So he's hesitant from getting married, and he showed me something that we're going to study in this daf, so I'm going to respond to him also on air. But before we go there, let's deal with our Mishnah. And the Mishnah, it's on page 32. The Mishnah tells us, "Ein puchatin et aner." Here we continue our discussion on festival. And they said, one may not hollow out a piece of clay to form a lamp. Now, what is that about? So the idea is, in those days, Rashi said, when they make an earthware for candle, it was a special process. In Israel, I saw it many times, they place earthware in, it looks like an egg, but having a hole, and then they put a fist inside it and move the fist right and left. Get that right?
Of a piece of clay?
Piece of clay.
Yeah, right.
And then they make it look like some type of vessel.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way they make the candle. So it's basically made out of chaymal, which is that the clay. And they make inside the hollow, it is called chakika, and then they put it in the hot temperature in the those days, some type of oven, and then they use it. So the problem is, it's called mipneishu sekli, meaning that he created a vessel. So some said that that this is building, it's bone. Some say that it's makeba patish, it's like completion, it's like hammering like completion of work. Ve'enosin, later we elaborate on that. Ve'enosin pechamin beyom tov. You cannot take a piece of wood that it's coral, it's very hot, and you want to use that coral later for other purposes. So the idea is, before you even put it together inside the oven, Rashi tells us, the inhu namei klininu letzorfei zahav. There are people who are using a gold metal, so they take those pieces of gold and they use a hot temperature to put them together. So they use this coal for that purpose. So the Rashi speaks about pecham, coal, that it's considering kli, a vessel. But the others have an issue with that, because they said, how about extinguishing kibui? So there are some, like the Ran, challenge this Rashi. Anyway, ve'ein chotchin et aptila. Later again, we elaborate, I just give you the idea that the person should not cut the wick, because it's a meaning a vessel. It's called tikkun kli. Rashi said, that's the asiyat tikkun kli. Rabbi Yehuda omer, Chotcha Ba'ur. Rabbi Yehuda said, guess what? If you need to use a knife to cut the wick, then is a issue. But if you take this wick, bring it close to the fire, and as a result, you have two pieces, then it's a different story. And as I said, later the Gemara elaborate on that. Man Tana de Pchitat Ner Manahu. Who is the Tana in our Mishnah that tells us that hollowing out a lamp, it's creating a vessel? So again, there are two, it's a process, two stages. Number one, Lachkok Tzura, to create a some type of image, a vessel. Number two, you take it and you put it inside the oven and you make tseiruf, you make it as a complete item. So who holds that this, considering makeba patish, which means completion of work before you put it inside the oven, who is the one who holds that way? That's the way Rashi said. Tosfot have a different way, but that's, I'm going by the Rashi. Amar Rav Yosef, Rabbi Meir, the Tanya, Kli Cheres Mematay Mekabel Tum'a. Now we digress for a second in order to understand the concept of vessel, earthware vessel. So he said, when that vessel is earthware vessel is susceptible to ritual impurity, meaning when it's considering a clear vessel, mishenigmera melachto, which means that when it turned to be a form of vessel, which call in Ivrit hakika, completion. Divrei Rabbi Meir, Rabbi Yoshua omer mishetzirfo bakivshan. So either Rashi said by heating it in the hot temperature, for example by oven, or the way that the Gemara said in Shabbat 41b, that by the other way around, you cool it off in a very cold water. But anyway, in order to make it a completion of an earthware, you go to that two stages, meaning that our Mishnah follow Rabbi Meir. Amar le Abaye, Abaye challenged Rav Yosef, and he said, Mimai, how do you, from where you come to conclusion that this Mishnah follow Rabbi Meir? Dilma, maybe. Ad kan lo kama Rabbi Meir atam. Maybe what Rabbi Meir said, that this earthware is susceptible to receive a ritual impurity, applies even before it reaches a stage of hot temperature, ela dechazei lekabulei be. As long as you take a vessel and you can put things in the vessel. So let's understand something as a definition. Trace a scenario. A person has a vessel. What's the purpose of vessel? Can be two. One, you cook. Or, for example, for our discussion, you put an oil and you put a wick and you make it a sort of candle. There is another purpose that not involving temperature, soon you see. It's just to have things inside. Sugar, flour, whatever it is, dry items.
Storage.
Storage, very good. Aval hacha lemai chazi. What exactly the Torah Kli, the vessels, involved here? I agree with you, he said, that when it's come to liquid part, you want to use it for oil, for water, or anything that involved with water, it can melt because of this process. However, in that stage, if you put dry item, as we said, sugar, flour, etc., you can use. So the Gemara responded and said, yes, when it's come to that earth rectangle, even before it completed its process of using a hot temperature in the oven, in the stove, whatever it is, to make it in such a level, lekabule beipshite. Everyone agrees, for example, to put coins in that vessel. It's considering a vessel. Even according to Rabbi Meir, it's a vessel. So another one, the stage of hakika, the stage of completion, that's considering kli, make it a vessel. Another option, ika de amri. Amar Rav Yosef, you know, this Mishnah follow a different one. Rabbi Eliezer b'Rabbi Tzadok hidetnan. Now the source is Mishnah in Tractate Adayot, chapter 2, Mishnah 5. Il pasin haraniyot. Here, the Gemara dealing with two different categories. People who live in fancy, fancy Manhattan, New York, or McLean, Virginia, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or in the beautiful places in Boston, like Jonathan, right?
Mm-hmm.
And versus people who live in whatever it is, no names, no place, but in those farmland, okay? So, in general, in Talmudic time, Ben Kfar, someone who live in a farmland, they live, for our discussion, a simple life. They can compromise and they are not, I hope I'm using the right word, fastidious. Which means, fastidious in my best understanding are people who are very fussy and very elegant, and they have to have everything perfect, you know.
Particular,
thank you. So, people, al-fasin haraniyot, those vessels that used by those kfar, by those farmlands, places that people not care to use the fancy vessels or fancy utensils. So it's enough for them that you take the basic vessels and they use it for the purpose of food, even without completion of process. Versus people in the cities, that's more fastidious, they are very aesthetic, and they want to make sure that the vessel completed. I know many people like that, in both ways. Like, when I was in the army, we used to share a pouch and mess things and everything, right? Versus, you know, in my current job, you know, there are many people who are very particular, using knife and fork and the manners and table, etc., etc., etc. Anyway, Tehorot be'Ohel HaMet. It's not receiving a ritual impurity and in the tent of a corpse, meaning in order to be susceptible for ritual impurity, it has to have a form, Beit Kibul, a form of vessel. Meaning the Torah said, V'chol Kli Patuach. The Torah said in Book of Bamidbar, Numbers, chapter 19. Any open vessel, which means the corpse makes anything that under, we explained several times, if anything under that tent become ritual impure, anything. So the Torah said any earthware vessel that is totally open, meaning you can put things inside that vessel, so then it's susceptible to ritual impurity. But Rashi said, if, for example, it's a flat earthware vessel, so it's not susceptible to ritual impurity. Meaning you need to have peh, you need to have a entrance point in order to be susceptible. Utmeot b'masa hazav, they become the susceptible to ritual impurity when you have zav. Zav is a person that have physical discharge, semen, or whatever it is. So he carries, he contain, he transfer his ritual impurity to that. So Now, what when it's come to Zav, we explain many times the different category of ritual impurity. One, which we call in our discussion Heiset, which means the susceptible of ritual impurity involved with either lying on that or sitting on something. So anything under him become ritual impurity. Now, the question is something that it's not tumat migabo, so not direct. So that's a question. So he said here, if he is carrying them, if he carries the vessel, it's considering a quote-unquote vessel, and therefore the Zav person will have a discharge, transfer, render ritual impurity even to those vessels who do not have a appearance, Beit Kibul, appearance of a vessel, meaning even something that's flat as long as he's carrying them. Rabbi Lazar be Rabbi Tzadok omer, af tehorot b'masazav. He said, no, those vessels, if the Zav person who have a discharge carry those, they are not susceptible to ritual impurity. Why? Lefi shelo nigmera melachtan. Here is the centerpiece. Since they are not completed, it's not completed, then it's not susceptible to ritual impurity. So here you see a hagdara, a definition of vessel, which is hakika, the second part, the heating part. As long as he's not reached that part in the oven, which means as long as it's the first part, it's not considered for that discussion as a vessel. Meaning, the Shita Mekubetzet tells us that this Mishnah matched Rabbi Eliezer ben Yaakov ben Tzadok, that the chisaron, the missing part, is called gbar melacha, that the work completed. So the big discussion among the Rishonim is if that's a everywhere or is just in our discussion here. Also, Tosfot here have an issue with that. He disputed Rashi. He said, do you speak only about caring or even touching? So, anyway, Amar le Abaye. Abaye responded to Rav Yosef and he said, Dilma ad kan lo kama Rabbi Lazar ben Tzadok hatam. When you're speaking about ilfasim haraniyot, meaning those vessels that made for the people in the farmland, those earthware vessels, it's considered by them a completion of a vessel even before the second stage. Is everyone with me? Mm-hmm. The first and the second stage? Ela dechaze lekabulein bemide. As long as that vessel can have something inside, and we explained several times, there are a lot of options what to use that vessel. Havalacha. Here we speak about what? Earthware, something that hallowed the candle, the wick. So it's very small. Lemai chazi, what are you going to do before tziruv, before completing it in a hot temperature? So therefore, even according to Rabbi Elazar and Rabbi Tzadok, it's not considering a vessel. The Gemara said, no. Lekabule bei pshite, guess what? Do you know those vessels that you put the little nickels, a little dimes, those small vessels? That, even the one we use here for candles, it can be used for that purpose, to collect small coins. So even before completion, before stage two, it's already considering as a vessel. Tanu Rabbanan, en pochatin et haner. The rabbis taught, one may not hollow out a lamp, ve'en osin ilfasin charaniyot, and one may not create charaniyot pot on a festival, the one we said in the villages, be'yom tov, on a festival. Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel matir bilpasim chaniyot. Why? He said that those are not considering a vessel, and therefore it's not an issue of makeba patish, completion of work. So even some rabbis say that it's also rabbinic prohibition, even it's not completed. Rabbi Shimon ben Elazar hold the way that we explained earlier, if you remember in 31, that if it's part of preparation for Simchat Yom Tov, is allowed. Mai charaniyot. Now we need to understand the definition of the word charaniyot. Amar Rav Yehuda iraniyot. Says, what is iraniyot? Mai iraniyot? Amar Rabbeye tza'ei chaklayata. He said the villages' balls, which means, again, as we said, those balls that used by people in the farmland, in the villages, that use even clay vessel that not fully form or fire, and they are not fastidious with those that not complete finish utensils. Then the second part of the Mishnah, ve'ein osim pechamim, one may not produce some type of crawl or
charcoals.
Thank you. On the festival. So the Gemara said pshita. That's obvious. Lemai chazi. What's the purpose of charcoal by themselves? So if it's not used for the festival, it's just imposing work that we shouldn't do on the festival, because it's not letzorech achila. It's not for the purpose of eating it. So Rashi explains in the Mishnah, as we said, that that's the prohibition of asiyat kli, and making it as a vessel. The Gemara said that in those days, people who made silver vessels, gold items, they didn't use charcoal for cooking or baking. They use it to make those golden vessels item. So therefore, you do not have a use in Yom Tov. And the Shita Mekubeset explains, so we do not do work or put ourselves in the extra effort if it's not for the purpose of the festival itself. So Tani Rabbi Chia responded, and he said, Lo nitzrecha, ela lemosran leol yarin lebobayom. So guess what the purpose? You have those people who are in charge for the bathhouse. In those days, they have a bathhouse. And people go there, and they have a process. They go there, for example, to some type of sauna. Mm-hmm. And then they go to a very cold water. And then they go to very hot water. I saw it in Europe, in a few places, that people does that.
Europe, yeah.
I saw it once in Boston, too. But anyway, so the people go to a sauna, I think it's called wet sauna, and then go to a very cold bath and very hot bath.
I think usually a dry sauna when they...
What?
It's usually a dry sauna when they...
Dry sauna.
Yeah, dry sauna, and then get...
Dry sauna.
Then cold water, then...
Cold water, and then
back into hot water.
And they
or
use,
back
in my best recollection, it's years back, very cold water and very hot water.
Mm-hmm, afterwards.
Anyway, so... In those days, they made this charcoal to be used by the people who heat those bathhouses. Mm-hmm. So bathhouses was like in those days, you're walking on the wood pieces, and underground, it was the place that they heat, and by being there, it warmed the body.
Right.
So he said, those people make these charcoals on the festival itself, for the purpose of the festival itself that people use, and therefore the Mishnah needs to prohibit it because it's making a vessel. So the Gemara challenged that and he said, wait a second, Uvo bayom mishare. Who told you that it's okay during the festival to heat to warm a water? Warming water, you know, using in a festival, it's not tzorech ochel nefesh.
Well, you're not allowed to bathe with warm water on the
Yom Tov. And you know why? if you remember when we studied Tractate Shabbat, page 40, we said that people saw those employee in the bathhouses, that they used warm water on Shabbat, and uneducated people walk in and they think that it was made before Shabbat.
So you have to give enough time after Shabbos for the water to be warmed up before you can use the bath.
Yes, and I think I told you once a story about several rabbis that are very strict, that they don't use even mikveh if it's hot on Shabbat. I remember once it was told when I was a yeshiva student about Shebina Rav, that he walked in the mikveh on Shabbat. It was a great sage in Israel, may rest in peace. And he stepped down one or two steps down, and he noticed in his feet that it's hot or very hot, whatever it is, and he dressed up and walked out. He didn't use it. So anyway, here it means that you don't make this charcoal on the festival, the Amar Rava. That's something that we studied in Tractate Brachot, page 27b. It was Rebbe who walked in the bathhouse on Shabbat in order lehazia, to, for some people they need that sweat. To have the body sweat. Right?
Question, Rabbi. If the person, if this water was warm even before the Shabbat and it was there already, warm, the person come on Shabbat and this is warm already.
Some rabbis said it's fine. Some rabbis said it's fine. Anyway, so he said, so it may happen that it was before the rabbinic decree. So someone, people went to that bathhouse. Even they don't use the tub for water, but they went there in order to go to the dry sauna, in order to sweat, to carry sweat in their body. And the sages then put a decree. They basically put a boundary. And they said, "Hachaname lehazia vekodem gzeira." He went there to go to the sauna, and it was before the rabbinic decree. So this, the idea, the Mishnah needs to tell us that this charcoal, it's making a vessel, Torat Kli, and therefore it's prohibited. Ve'ein chotchin et haptila. You don't cut the wick. So there's a version that said Lishnayim to two, not everyone hold. Anyway, Rabbi Yehuda said that specifically with knife you can do it, but you can use the fire. In other words, you take the wick, you put it close to the fire, and then by itself it will cut to two pieces. Ma'ishna besakin delo. What's the problem to use a knife? Why that one may not cut a wick with a knife? 32b, dimtaken mana, because it's hereby manned a vessel, and although it was a week, and turned to two. So he said, ba'ur name metaken mana, using a hut, a fire, it's also preparing a vessel for use. So I just a side note, I want to remind you that our previous discussion applies to mikveot. We're not speaking about a fellow that have in his house jacuzzi and things like that. We talk about mikveot. Anyway, back to our subject. So it may be also metaken mana, a mending a vessel. Tani Rabbi Chiya, chotcha ba'ur befi shtenerot. So a person cut it using a fire with a mouth of two candles, meaning he needs two pieces. So he meant to do just hadlaka, just to fire it, but not mending a vessel. That's the way Rashi said. The Ran tell us from the Yerushalmi, he said, as long as he is in need of two candles. And the Shulchan Aruch wrote in Taf Kuf Yud Dalet Seif Chet, he said clearly that that's the condition that he needed for that purpose. The Mishnah Berurah, just a point, he says, "Demuchach le'adlaka be'alma velo tikun mana," that it's clear he needs to use it for kindling and not mending a vessel. So he added and he said, "Da, you should know. Din ze benel shava o cheres. That's applied to a kedels used for wick or earthware." But he said, "Besakin asu." If you're using a knife, is a problem. Can do it, but a regular manner, it's okay. Now, Amar Rav Natan bar Abba, Amar Rav, mochatin et haptila b'yom tov. He said that one may mold a week on a festival. My mochatin, what does that mean, mold? Amar Rav Chanina bar Shlemia, la'aduyei chushcha. One needed to remove the dark, which means it's permitted to remove the burn charcoal section to make the lamp shine more brightly. You're lighting the candles and then you remove that charcoal part at the top. So here is a machloket between the Rambam and the Ravid. Based on this, on the Rashi here, he said that that's darkened the light of the candle. If you have that shoko. So the Rambam said the problem is specifically using a vessel. Davka bekli. The Ravid said mutar al yedei kli. You can use a vessel, it's fine. Shulchan Aruch prohibited. The same as the Rambam. But it's a big discussion among the Rishonim how you do that. You're using a needle to do it, you're using by your hand, etc. The Mishnah Berurah said it's not considering a metaken, amending a vessel like the Ravid, but he ended up by saying Nagu Lachmir, that Mishnah Berurah said that we have the notion, the minag, that to be stringent, ben bayad ben bakli, both using hand or using vessels. Anyway, Tanei Bar Kapara. Now he brings more halachot that we learn in regards to weeks. Shisha dvarim ne'emru bepetila. There are six items made when it's come to using a wick on a festival. Shlosha le'achmir u'shlosha le'akel. Three we hold stringencies, and three we are lenient. Le'achmir, the three that we are stringent, is one, en godlin otan lechatchila biyom tov. One may not spin or twist lechatchila on a festival. Why? Because that's tikkun mana. That's mending the vessels. That's the way the Meiri said. And there are others, like Shaar HaTzion said, that it's also some type of toveh. It's one of the melachot. Ve'en mehavhevin ota ba'u. It's also one may not singe it in fire before lighting it, so in order for that to be burned well, so it's also considering making it a vessel. Ve'en chotchin ota leshnayim, and he's not cutting it to two pieces. So that's stringent. And now, because of metaken kli, or lehakel, to be lenient, one mema'acha bayad. If he uses his hand to crush it, so in order to be strong and lit clearly and beautifully, that's the answer. Why? Because it's considering kilachar yad, is not the direct manner of preparation of vessel. Number two, veshora bashemen, and he leave it with, soak it with the oil in order to be burned well. That's the Mishnah Berurah, and Mishnah Berurah add to that and Taf Kuf Yud Aleph, and he said that's specifically if you use a vessel for oil, because otherwise is a problem. And veshora b'shemen vechotcha ba'or, and the number three, and he may cut it by fire in the mouth of two candles, as we said earlier. So since we brought a memra, a statement from Rabbi Natan Bar Abba, so he brought other statements from him. Number one, Atirei Bavel Yordei Geinomhem. The wealthy people, the wealthy Jews who live in Babylon, they're going to Gehinom. How do you say it? Hell? Whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because they don't have compassion on poor people, and they don't give tzedakah, greedy people. Kiha de Shabtai Bar Marinus, it was a fellow, poor fellow, that Ikla Lebavel, he came as a shaliach to Babylon. Be'a minayu iska. So at the beginning he didn't ask for fund, he just asked the people there, give me some business. For example, give me merchandise that for the cost price, and I'll sell it, and I'll make you make a living. And I'll share with you the benefit. And they refused. V'lo yavu lo. They didn't give it. Mezone. So he said, if that's the case, I'm poor and I need charity, I need fund. V'lo yavu lo. They don't give it. Mezan lo zainu. Amar. Hanei me'erev rav. He says, this one, it's part of the mixed multitude. So the Torah tells us in few places, in the book of Shmot, chapter 12, Rashi said, and others, they said that it was a people that joined our ancestors when they left Egypt. Egyptians, non-Jewish Egyptians. They joined them not because they want to be part of Jewish destiny, but because they take advantage of their previous slaves that they are now free. They want to join us because they figure out they will have a better life. So they marry our people in order to be out of Egypt, or in order to be a better materialistic life. So, and later on, those people, when our people involved with challenges, when we are in a desert, and it was all those challenges, the people were troubled all the time, complaining, let's go back to Egypt, Moses brought us here to kill us, and all this constant complaining that makes Hashem very angry, were basically Erev Rav, those multitudes. So this fellow Shabtai, he called the people in Babylon, they are a descendants of those people, because the way they behave. He says, Amar Hane Me'erev Rav Ka'atu, and he bring a proof, because the Torah said, Ichtiv, they said in Book of Deuteronomy, chapter 13, Venatan Lecha Rachamim, Verichamcha. So meaning that part of Midot, part of the trait of Jewish people, it's people of compassion. Kol amerachem al abriyot biyadua shu mizar'o shel Avraham Avinu. Marsha said that Avraham was the one who commanded his future generation to involve with tzedakah, with helping others. So someone who show compassion to other people, he is a descendant, he or she a descendant of Abraham. Bekol misheinu merachem al abriyot biyadua shu mizar'o shel Avraham Avinu. Anyone who doesn't have compassion upon people, he is not a descendant of Abraham. Since we talk a memra, a statement from him, so we bring another one. V'amar Rav Natan Bar Abba Amar Rav, kol ha-metzapeh al shulchan acherim. He says, anyone who depends upon food, to get food, to sit in table of other people, so Olam chashach ba'ado. His world is dark. I explained in my book, Birak Lomar Berashi. Rashi said here, Kemo chashach ba'ado, klomar choshech parus lefanav. So Rashi explained here the definition, that it means not literally, but it's more euphemism, using the line, that his life is in darkness. Shenemar, they said in the book of Job, chapter 15, Noded hu lalechem aye, yada ki nachon biyado yom choshech. He wandered aboard for bread. Where is it? He knows the day of darkness is ready at his hand. Meaning, a person who's meandering, who's traveling, and doesn't know if he have a food to put in his mouth the next day, So he's thinking that the next thing that happened is darkness. Rav Chisda Amar, Rav Chayav and Rav Chaim. Rav Chisda said also he has no life because he's always living in darkness, and that's the Marsha said that that's implication to death. Tanu Rabbanan. So now we connected to what Rav Chisda said. The rabbis tells us, three people has no life. Do you remember I told you about the single fellow that came and talked about his dilemma to get married or not to get married? Like Hamlet said, to be or not to be, right? So he said, he brought this Gemara. Ve'iluen, here are the three. One, Hamtzapeh l'shulchan acherim. One who looks for the table, meaning he needs food, for his sustenance from other people. Two, ומי שישתו מושלת עליו, if someone married to someone that she controlling him. Do you know anyone like that? Mm-hmm. I know.
Mm-hmm. Pretty much everyone that's married.
You said if she have the pants, right?
She wears the pants.
Wears the pants, right?
That's right. She rules in the house anyway.
And one that his body is ruled by suffering. Marsha said here that the problem with his wife is she's not letting him study Torah. That's the problem with him. And he elaborated and he said when he's talking about someone whose body is ruled by suffering, meaning is like a story of Rabbi Eliezer and Rabbi Shimon, that he accepts upon himself suffering, but only at night. And he called it Yisurei Ahava. Anyway, v'yesh umrim, and there are those who said, af mi she'en lo ela chaluk echad, someone who has only one robe. So in those days, someone has one robe can have lice. You know, disgusting lies. So they said v'tanakama. So why he said he's not put it in the list of someone who has no life if he have one robe? Said the afsha the mine the mana, that sometimes he have a chance to search and take out those disgusting lies in his robe. But anyway, the idea is that these people has no life. Anyway, I look at your faces and I'm not sure if you understand those statements. So
no, I understand.
Anyway, so that fellow brought this Gemara and he said, so should I get married or not? Anyway, the Mishnah said, Ein shovrin et acheres, ve'en chotchin et aniyar. So the next Mishnah dealing with situation when you need to roast fish is very different than roasting meat. Why? Because roasting fish is very sensitive. If you don't do it right, you can ruin it. Mm-hmm. In this society, you know, if someone will give you a bagel and he said, do you want a burned bagel? He said, that's disgusting, I'm not going to eat it. But if they give you a Cajun food, right, Cajun fish, and they say, do you want to eat it? He said, sure. And if you said no, they think that you are, you know, you're not educated, you're not part of the society.
Different, so though, that's
you
not
have
burned.
People who are walking around with stomach ache, you know, for a long time, and they develop a taste of Cajun food. But anyway, I'm joking.
It's black and not burned. It's different.
Anyway. So, I don't know. There are certain food that they made it a certain way. Rashi explained here that they use a reshet. They use a special way they taking a earthware, they breaking it, and then that's the way they did it in those days, and the heat come from below And this way, you basically roasted the fish. The problem is that that matechet, that part, can be very hot, and you can get burned even, and it's burned the fish. So you don't do that. Ve'ein chotchin et haniyar. One may not cut paper in order to roast the salted fish on it. Litzlot bo maliach. So later, the Gemara elaborate what's the issue here. Ve'en gorfin tanur v'chirai, and one may not sweep out an oven or stove. Aval mechabshin, one may press down any flattened that accumulate dust and ashes on the bottom of the oven. Ve'en makifin shtei chaviyot, and one may not draw two barrels together. Lishpot alehen et hakdeira, to place a pot on them, so that contain will cook by fire lit between the barrels. Ve'ein somchin et hakdeira bibkat, and one may not prop a pot with a piece of wood. Ve'chen bedelet, in the same way with a door. So it means that you don't attach this one to the door. Ve'ein manigim et ha-beima b'makel b'yom tov. In those days, they used to lead the animal. If you go to some villages in some countries, you still see it. So one may not lead an animal with a stick in a public domain on a festival, because that vessel can be used only for heating purposes. Rabbi Lazar and Rabbi Shimon matir. Rabbi Lazar and Rabbi Shimon allow it. My tama. The Gemara said, "What's the reason?" He said, "Mishum dem takan dekam metaken mana." It's basically one preparing, fixing, mending a vessel for use. Ven gofim tanu vechirai. Tan Rabbi Chia bar Yosef kamed Rabbi Nachman viyfshar lefot elan ken gofom mutar. If you have no other choice but to sweep it out, it's permitted. Story, the video of Rav Chia nafal arikha b'turan yom ataba, the wife of Rav Chia, she have an issue that half of the brick fell into the oven on a festival. So Amar Rav Chia, chazedan arifta me'alta b'ina. So I explain here in my book, it's a Rashi, klomar girfiya tanu, he said to her, look, I want a high quality bread, so he asked her to sweep the oven. Amar l'rava l'shamay tavli bar'ar v'izahar micharucha. So again, I explained in here in my book that you make sure that it's not, he warning not to be careful not to sing it, so that may remove all implements from the oven in order to fulfill the requirement, because otherwise it will not be possible to cook without singeing. Amar l'Ravino l'Rav Ashi, Amar l'an Rav Acha Mehutzal, the name of place, the mar that Rav Ashi, he says, when you roasted meat, sharkim etanu b'yom ataba. The servants will do it around the cover for him on the festival, the oven. Amar lei anan arakta defrat samchinan. I rely on the bank of the Ethiopian river, because so we don't make a new one on a festival. This apply only when one wrap it from the day before, so it's not an issue of mukzeh. Ravina said that needling with ashes is okay, since the labor of kindling does not apply to ashes. Ve'im makifin shtei chaviyot, one may not draw two barrels together in order to put a pot on them. Amar Rav Nachman, avanim shel beit hakiseh mutar litzadan biyom tov. So in those days they use a stone for bathroom, so you're allowed to do it, to sit on the festival. Because there's some concern about mukzeh. And the idea is called kvod abuyot, out of people, because they need to use it. Eidi v'Rav Nachman, en makivim shtei chaviyot lishpot alehem takdira. You don't put together two barrels in order to place the pot on them. So here you see contradiction. So why are you allowed to put these pieces in the stone. In the what the stone for the beta kisya marle shani atam mishnah is different mishum de kavida ala, because over there it's one make a ten, so it's not drawing of the barrel close together that's prohibited. The placement of part over the form of a kind of covering, it's very much to bonel building a ten. Amar Rabba Zuta le Rabashi, Ela me'ata, what you said now, Bana it's taba, if one build a solid bench, Be Yom Tov during the festival, that doesn't have a whole anodat, Dula vidala, he doesn't create a ten, Hachana medeshah, you say that it's permissible, but it's not. Amar le'atam, Binyan keva satra, the Torah prohibited a permanent building. Binyan arai, temporary, like setting up the barrels, לא אסרה תורה. The Torah had not prohibited. וגזרו הבנן בעניין הרי משום עניין קבע. The rabbis put one prohibition for permanent construction, temporarily construction because of permanent construction, meaning that setting the barrel it's rabbinic prohibition. ויחם משום כבודו לא גזרו בי. And here, for, due to the dignity of the user, using the bathroom, the sages did not put the prohibition. Amar of Yehuda, Hayd Meduta. We just said that's this bonfire, which is the wood is arranged in a form of house. So he said, Mile mala lemata shari. If from the above to below it's permitted. That's not the usual way of building. But preparing it in the unusual manner, for example, Mile mata lemala, which is the way that it's not so asur, because why? Because that's considering a constructing a building, bone ohel. 33, vechen bi'ata, and similarly in regards to an egg of the mouth of the hollow vessel or on a grill sitting above coal, so he must first hold the vessel in his hand and put the egg on it, and only afterward position them both on the coal. וכן גדרה וכן בוטיה וכן חביתה. And similarly, bed and similarly pot, bed and barrels. So the upper side must be held in a place first, and then the added below. See the halacha, even machshir yochel nefesh, even the preparation for food, it's prohibited, permissible, I'm sorry, permissible. Now the Shulchan Aruch HaChaim 5:15 said, it is prohibited to fashion a lamp of clay into a shape of a lamb in order to create a receptacle, because it's considering creating a vessel. And one may not produce charcoal on a festival, even if it's needed for cooking purposes. That's Shulchan Aruch HaChaim 5:02. Earthware vessels are not susceptible to ritual impurity until the manufacture has been completed, which is after having the fire in the furnace. And that's basically the Rambam, Hilchot Kelim, chapter 15. On a festival, Chotcha Ba'ur, Shulchan Aruch HaChaim 5:14. On festival, one may cut wick only by means of fire, by placing it at the end of the wick in two lamps. One may cut the wick with an implement, that's basically Rabbi Yehuda Bar Chiya, and he may do so only if he require two lamps. So one may not twist or singe a wick on a festival, but is permitted to crush it by hand or soak it on oil. That Shulchan Aruch HaChaim 5:14. Sweeping out an oven, if it's possible to bake in an oven without sweeping it out, such as the bread will not sink, one may not sweep it because it's unnecessarily handling. That's the Magen Avraham. However, one may arrange its coal and ashes so they do not touch the bread. One may not arrange the earth on the bottom, which is Mukzeh, but more on that is the Mishnah Berurah on Shulchan Aruch HaChaim 5:07. We talk about a preparation of a bonfire. That's Shulchan Aruch HaChaim 5:02. And That's basically the final halakha. We said here that when making a bonfire, one should not arrange the wood in a usual manner. Rather, the upper piece should be suspended while the other are placed beneath them, or the wood should be placed in no particular order. That's basically Rav Yehuda's opinion. Some maintain that this applies only to a if the bonfire is arranged in two rows. That's very similar to walls, but more on that is the Magen Avraham on Shulchan Aruch or Chaim 502.
Shuloim, Malachai, Shuloim, Malachai.